Good evening. It's January 12, 2017. I'm Ramon. It's Bold Like a Leopard. A couple points of disorganization. Put up three stories earlier today. One of them was concerning Michelle Obama and Hillary Clinton, their political prospects for the future. Another one was dealing with the Meryl Streep Golden Globes speech. And the third one had to do more with the Senate confirmation. I think it was the one. Yeah, the Senate confirmation hearings and just the issue of Rand Paul staying or leaving the GOP, which it's not a story as of right now. I would say it's time to start encouraging Rand Paul to leave the GOP. So that's really more of a personal take. Now, the story today, this is where the fun comes in, is Pissgate. They're calling it Pissgate, or at least Sticks, Hex, and Hammer is calling it. I really respect his channel the most. I think that's the one that I look at first every day. There's also Golden Shower Gate and everything. And what's so frustrating to me, and I'm going to take like a, try to be philosophical about this as little as possible, but there are certain issues that I do have to include. Look, what's so frustrating to me is that I do want to present a lot of my serious just analysis, the stuff that I think is my strong suit, which is on policies. I already did the two on job creation and on Obamacare. I could probably do more on those two topics. There just isn't enough time on my schedule. I do have a day job. And there's one that's upcoming that I did work on today on education, and it might have to go into the Trump term. So I'd like to present to you videos on the serious issues of Obama and his 8 years as the president, maybe a little on the outlook from here under President-elect Trump. Excuse me. But unfortunately, CNN, they had to come in and do a little intermission from real life, as if this entire election hasn't been an intermission from, you know, adulthood for them, where they just jump on every dumbass blurb out there. And this was no different. Apparently they, and you know, I'm not following the story detail for detail, but it's already exploded so big that the details don't even matter anymore. But the story is that there was some sort of fabricated rumor on 4chan about where there was a published story where Donald Trump apparently was in a fake intelligence dossier from British intelligence MI6, staying in a Russian hotel and going on some sort of racial tirade regarding Obama. And he hired a bunch of Russian prostitutes that pissed on his bed. And that's the short story of it. I don't think that, I mean, how much more can, you could probably, if you really want to elaborate, go read the story. Go read what they said was the story. That's what's so funny, that it's so ridiculous that I couldn't tell the story any better than the fake news people did. And it brings to us the issue of where is the future of journalism going? I think a few years ago, the outlook was that you could start a new journalist organization. They were starting Vox, and Vice, which had already been around, was just breaking new ground all the time. Just better investigative journalism, better reports from foreign countries. I love their work in Pakistan. And all the time we were thinking, even though it was a frustrating era for people who were opposed to the politics of the Obama administration, there was this feeling that we were in a new frontier of media due to the social media aspect of it, due to the you know, Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, 4chan, Reddit. That was the feeling that it was. And instead, what happened was that it did expose. I mean, it's created a new media frontier. But the people that were thought to be the pioneers are basically dying in the desert. It's almost as if they're dying on the Oregon Trail. And I think the worst victims now are some of these legacy media outlets. That's what a lot of these the new media are calling them. Legacy media, meaning cable TV. And then there's the fake blogs. There's the Daily Beast. There's you could say Talking Points Memo and all those so-called clarifying websites. Talking Points Memo. There's what is that? CTR, Correct the Record. Those are now plainly known to be just fronts for the Democratic Party. And then there's the Huffington Post, which is right now just a message board for all sorts of social justice campaigners. You know, they call themselves warriors, but what does that even mean? You know, SJWs is now a slur. That's the environment they created for themselves. And Pissgate, I think, is, and I laugh all day. Look, I was at work today, and I work with coolant, yellow coolant. So I was giggling like a retard the whole day looking at yellow coolant. You know, you'd walk by any liquid and you just laugh because you're thinking, you know, Golden Shower Gate, all that stuff. This is such a disgrace, and we're gonna get into some other aspects of it. And it's ironic that it came, what was it, a day or two after Meryl Streep had said that the media should do its job. Well, this is to you, Meryl Streep. This is the media doing its job. They're reporting opinion, or even worse than opinion, they're reporting rumor. They're reporting innuendo. CNN wasn't willing to actually document or spell out the full extent of this rumor about Donald Trump hiring a bunch of Russian prostitutes. So they had to resort to innuendo. And that's the classy media that you've stood up there defending. They're not willing to actually verify the sources and do the basic journalistic practices that they claim that they want to uphold. They just want to stay relevant. They just want to throwing up bricks like they're the Brooklyn Nets right now. That's what CNN is. That's what BuzzFeed is. You could look at all the media outlets. Some of them are going to stop trying eventually. And you have them going down to, that's another thing I want to talk about, Capitol Hill. You have this issue with the painting in Congress. Look, there was so much coverage of this story where you have the Democrats putting up and the Republicans unscrewing it and taking it down. What a waste of time. That just shows we have two parties that are focused on, if the painting is up, does that help save any black lives? Does that help save anybody in St. Louis? I found out today St. Louis apparently is a murder oasis in Missouri that might even be worse than Chicago. I was hearing statistics about it. I'm going to investigate it more. But what good does it do to keep that painting up? They're making this statement about police officers. Well, your police officers are now just cloistered around. They don't want to get sued. They don't want to get their lives ruined. So you're having criminals run your cities and intimidate the innocent, intimidate your constituents. That's what you're getting out of it. That painting is not going to change that. And Republicans, you taking down the painting, that's no better. Okay, I looked at the painting artistically. You know, people, the art is a matter of taste. I thought whoever made the painting, they did a good job. It's visually very, you know, interesting composition. You know, I'm not an art freak. I have a friend who's a studio art PhD. A lot of good that does him. He's working as a machinist now. He's a great guy. But the point is that you're taking down a piece of art. What are you focused on? You should be focused on reducing our national debt, and taking a painting down has nothing. It's almost as if you came up there. It's like you're fighting over the same dorm space, the Democrats and the Republicans, and that's the tragedy of it. And they're saying it's a freedom of speech issue because, you know, obscenity laws and whether you're allowed to display controversial art in a federal building. I don't really care because at some point they didn't make it about freedom of speech. At some point that I think his name is Lacey Gray or Lacey, it's Lacey something. Lacey Dixon maybe. That congressman from Missouri who is demanding that the painting stay up because it was made by one of his constituents. In the contest rules, it did state which type of art could be displayed in the Capitol. So to me, it's not an issue of freedom of expression. It's an issue of they decided to make an exception for this painting. Okay, that's within their rights. If it's ruled by the House that this isn't the type of art that's approved by its rules, then I don't really care if it's a freedom of speech issue or not. They can, you know, make little motions about which house ferns can be put in the house hallways. They can put motions, you know, which scones can be put in the cafeteria. Nobody gives a fuck about a piece of art that you're hanging there. And these statements you're making that about these police officers and then you call the police on this congressman that unscrewed it, this Duncan Hunter, who I think is he's well known for his anti-immigration views. You are just now really just digging deeper. That's what I see out of this. You know, both parties in Congress, they're not focusing on the important things, and I think it's going to hurt the Democrats more. Because the Republicans are a party that's in many districts they're the default party. There's no interest on their part in having a person that promotes the type of values that the Democrats are promoting. That's the difference. I was watching another video today. That's the difference between the Democrats and the Republicans. In most of the Republican districts, the majority. Doesn't matter if it's a silent majority or a non-silent majority, a vocal majority, they agree with their traditional values in a lot of these districts. Don't tell me in Kansas, there might be Democrats in Kansas, but in reality, the Democrats are not endorsing the values that the National Democratic Party is promoting, by and large. I was watching today that this video from Rebel Media in Canada, where Laura Southern was this is what the left is exhibiting right now. She's going to this rally to interview people talking about transgender pronouns, and they're protesting a professor that refuses to acknowledge transgender pronouns. And I put the video up on Bold Like a Leopard, BOLD in capital letters, on Facebook. And what you see there is these protesters that they want attention, and then when they get it, they don't like it. They were saying, you can't interview us, we're not trans women. You know, they were saying, oh, we're cis women or something, which are words that are, they're speaking their own language, and they want people that don't speak the language to come and cover them and just translate their fruit salad of views to the public. Yeah, I said fruit salad, okay? Pardon the pun. Their fruit salad views is that you're going to throw in all this terminology that is completely made up. It's based on nothing. It's not based on science for sure. And you're making up these genders. And when people show up to actually talk about it, then you criticize the media coverage. You wanted the media coverage, and then when it shows up, you don't want it so much. So they were harassing these two Pakistani people that were there, that were not. They were trying to talk to the rally people, but they weren't having it. And then they were. What else was there? Blocking the camera. There's a girl picking her nose in front of the camera. Everybody picks her nose, but this girl was. You know, you're really showing how sophisticated and forward-thinking you are. By demonstrating in front of a camera at a demonstration that you don't want to talk. What are you really gaining? And that's the message that I think is what we're receiving now. There's this this sense on the left that the bow has been breached and they're taking on a lot of water. And all the rats are just jumping off the ship. They're all claiming that they're anti-establishment when they are the establishment. The establishment is just falling apart. So as far as I'm concerned, that's really the issue here. We have a leftist tendency in academia, in the media, in much of the government, including the courts. And they believe that they're still the rebels. You're not the rebels when you're sitting on the bench and issuing rulings, or if you're lecturing from the lectern. It doesn't work that way. Once you get to that spot, that makes you part of the establishment as well. As much as it hurts to think about that, once you've reached the height of power, your revolution now becomes an administration. And if we're talking about the media specifically, I think that this BuzzFeed and CNN case about Pissgate, and you know, I still love saying that word. I'm gonna probably be laughing tomorrow like some sort of madman or schizophrenic every time I look at any bottle of liquid now. You just triggered me. You know, I don't have any control anymore. That's what's so funny about it. What I'm gonna compare it to, I'm gonna try to get through this, okay? I can't believe I'm doing this late and after having a full meal, but how could I not? And I don't care if there's no viewers. It's that funny that I'm going to come and watch this years later and just laugh. This was me in 2017 laughing about a fake story about the president-elect hiring a bunch of Russian prostitutes to piss on a bed in Moscow. What I'll compare this to is, you know, there's this trend going on. There was the Gawker case that everybody's mentioned. I saw on Lionel earlier, they mentioned it, and I think the Sticks alluded to it, not directly though, that they sued, the Hulk Hogan sued Gawker for true video that was sexually compromising. And they won, and they basically bankrupted Gawker. Beyond that, there's two other stories that this brings to mind. There was the Dan Rather story, where in the mid-2000s he started publishing these documents, these mimeographs, or I think they're mimeograms. The mimeograph is the device where they were allegedly documents from George Bush's military service claiming that he was trying to avoid deployment to Vietnam and whatever, and getting away with AWOL or something. This is so long ago. And this is I'm not gonna rehash everything that was in it. And Dan Rather took it up, and CBS News took it up. And eventually it was discovered that not only were the documents forgeries, but the person who had given them to CBS News admitted that they were not real, and basically in kind of a statement that was I don't remember how they caught him, but they discovered that he'd fabricated the documents. The fonts in them were not available on typewriters back in the 60s, and to this day Dan Rather continues to maintain that this Bush draft dodging story is true, which he didn't dodge the draft. Remember, he was in the National Guard. Apparently nowadays it's disputable. Look, I don't know if he really wanted to go to Vietnam, as some of his supporters say. I don't think it's true. I think if he wanted to go to Vietnam, he would have gotten in. It's sort of a fruitless argument right now whether he did or did not want to go to Vietnam. The point is that after a long investigation, CBS News, which had Dan Rather had been their, he'd been their banner, their flag, he was the masthead on their ship, was forced out, and so was his producer that worked on that story, whose name escapes me now. They made a story, or they made a movie, I think in 2015, called Truth, based on the whole incident. It was a bomb, a box office bomb. Robert Redford starred in it. I'm still trying to find, you know, you can find it. It's like, they basically screw you over on Amazon. I think it's like $17 for the film, just to watch it on Amazon Prime. Anyway, so Dan Rather gets sacked from CBS News, gets hired by this little-known Action News, AXN. And then nowadays he's doing this sort of journalist, like television magazine, and they're having him do journalistic reports. As far as I'm concerned, when somebody gets caught doing something like that and they don't admit their fault, like happened with Dan Rather, who still maintains to this day that it was a true story, even though it's been debunked numerous times. I think that once you do that, why hire him at all? It's the same thing with Brian Williams. They rehired him after his famous helicopter fire incident or whatever happened in Iraq. That's the treatment they give to each other. They have some sort of fraternal brotherhood where you can lie as much as you want, you can get caught, you can look like a retard, and they'll still hire you back. It's the same thing that happened with Rolling Stone. In 2014, towards the end of the year, I think it was in November, they published this story called A Rape on Campus. It turned out that, and the story was about a woman who'd endured a gang rape at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville, which I've been to that campus. It's probably, I don't do a lot of traveling. I was there. I'd have to say it's one of the most well-kept, nicest campuses I've ever seen. I have been to a few college campuses. So I was there in, I think, 2002. And the whole story turned out to be a fabrication by some sort of attention-hungry woman who'd been going to the college, and her friends, her friends disputed her version of events. They claimed it was made up, and the Rolling Stone, it took them months to admit any wrongdoing, and even then they refused to take the story down, and they claimed that there were inaccuracies. It was only in spring of 2015 that after Columbia School of Journalism did an investigation of the story and revealed that there had been virtually no corroboration of the facts that Rolling Stone admitted any wrongdoing. It was called the worst piece of journalism of the year of 2014, I think, by the Columbia School of Journalism, which itself is a liberal educational institution. So even by their standards, it was considered the worst journalistic piece of 2015. The same journalist, Sabrina Ardelli Rubin, who wrote this piece and did the quote-unquote investigation, you know, she was never fired by Rolling Stone. It was revealed later that she'd had the same dubious reporting procedure for a different story regarding priest sexual abuse in Philadelphia, where it turned out that one of the men that was convicted, a priest in Philadelphia, turned out that the story was completely untrue, that the victim had fabricated the story against him at least. And she had never done her due diligence and investigated it, and investigated his the victim's credibility, and whether he could be trusted. What happened with Sabrina Ardelli? No stories have appeared since then, but she remains on the Rolling Stone payroll, as I believe she's some sort of editor. You know, they keep her in some sort of basement there in Manhattan, where, you know, Jan Wenner once in a while comes down to visit her, like she's some sort of escaped convict or something. What happened last month, I believe, or maybe no, it was right after the election, maybe. The administrator for the University of Virginia, who were the real victims of Sabrina Ardelli and Rolling Stone, sued her. This administrator sued her, Nicola Ramo, for defamation of character, for claiming that she'd done nothing to investigate the sexual assault, and that she'd ignored the victim's complaint about sexual assault. And she won, I believe, $3 million. And there's another pending lawsuit by the fraternity in the University of Virginia And I don't have the story in front of me. I don't remember which fraternity. That's what I'm trying to say. But that for and it's irrelevant. You can look it up. I could probably do a different video on that, and I can source the material while I'm uploading the video. So look for it in the comments below. There is a lawsuit by that fraternity against Rolling Stone, I believe, for $25 million. So based on the fact that they've already judged against Rolling Stone regarding this administrator who was defamed in the lawsuit, if they were to lose this second lawsuit to these frat boys, Rolling Stone as a political commentary magazine will be done. Okay, they should have already been done when they admitted that the story was a fabrication they can claim that it wasn't an intentional fabrication. But at the end of the day, intent or no intent, they published a story that didn't meet even the most basic journalistic criteria. It was one of those stories that would appear in some sort of communist propaganda magazine about like in North Korea, where they had the video where they took a video of a homeless shelter and they depicted that as America. And you had this narration claiming that, you know, they were eating their clothes or something. I remember that video was one of the funniest I've ever seen. And that's the way Rolling Stone does their journalism right now when it comes to verifying the facts. So based on that, how that judgment goes, and there's already been a judgment in November, what I expect could happen, given what happened at the press conference today, where Trump basically told the CNN reporter to go fuck himself, calling him fake news, I think that they could be in for a major problem if the Trump organization, remember, it's not just Trump as an individual, his organization can sue CNN for negative for defamation of the organization too, because Trump was the president and director of the Trump organization during the time in question while he was allegedly in Moscow. If they can find that there was malicious intent, CNN could be in major trouble. There's already a lawsuit that most people don't know about related to CNN discriminating against blacks in their newsrooms and in their other employment capacities. And we're looking now at a major earthquake in the news media. They're no longer able to go out there and say, depend on us, we're the worldwide leader in news. Because once you cross that river and start publishing just gossip and hearsay and made up fantasy that came off of the internet and everything, once you get caught doing that, your credibility goes to the toilet. You're no longer, you become cut from the, you're, you know how they say, we're not cut from the same cloth. Well, this time the cloth's magically changed. You turn from silk to burlap in a second. That's what happened with CNN on this story. When you start your day saying that you're the worldwide leader in news, and then you publish a story where you claim somebody was in Moscow on a date where apparently he was not, and you claim there's a dossier from British intelligence. I mean, who the hell are you to start lecturing people on fake news and Trump's hostility to the media? Then they come to the press conference and they behave like he owes them some sort of answer. You just published a report where you try to corroborate not even corroborate. You want to lend credence by featuring it on your website and on your newsfeed to a story where he hired Russian prostitutes to piss on a bed in Moscow that you have no verification on. So where's your credibility now? I mean, if I was to publish, look, if there's a story out there about Anderson Cooper taking hamsters up his butt, I mean, I can just publish it now, and does that entitle me to go up to his studio and demand answers from him? There's stories that have been around for years, and you know, I was just on Lionel's videos, I interact with the videos. I've never actually sent him a message, but he was asking, what is your favorite urban legend, basically? I don't remember what he called it, but it's an urban legend. And my favorite one, everybody always mentions, and he mentioned it, the Rod Stewart one where he had his stomach pumped from all this semen or something. That's not the story that I've always thought was hilarious, and I've always wondered if it's true, was if Phil Collins watched a man drown that his wife was cheating on him with, and that's where In the Air Tonight came from. That's his song, and if you listen to the song, it really sounds like that. And from now on, what are they supposed to do? Go ask Phil Collins about, does that entail them now to go ask Phil, hey, did you watch, Jeff drown over there in the Thames or wherever it was? No, it doesn't lend you the just because you accuse somebody of something that you have no evidence of, that you picked up off of some message board or off of BuzzFeed, that doesn't entitle you to a spot. If he can, there's other reporters there. That's that he decided not to call on you. He decided to show you the middle finger by not even mentioning you by name, but basically trashing you. And you should know now that CNN has caught a hold of the tiger's tail, and they don't know how to let go. And they should find a way to let go already, and cut their losses and maybe turn a new leaf. I believe that there will have to be an overhaul in their management in order for them to recover their reputation. CBS still hasn't recovered their reputation since Dan Rather. I was looking up who is their presenter now. I couldn't even recognize the guy's name. It was Scott something. Scott Pelley, I think. And that's how bad the Rather scandal was. And this could be even worse. Because the person who fabricated the Bush story apparently had a tangential connection to Bush's military service. He was an officer that was in the same unit, in the Air National Guard and everything. There was something there. It just was a manipulation by somebody involved. Here, we might not have anything. It might be something that was like just a complete prank. Apparently that's what happened on 4chan. It was just one of these trolls fabricated this dossier and somebody picked it up. Whether he intended that to happen or not, that's a good question. And if he did, that's probably one of the funniest, one of the greatest troll actions ever, if you appreciate those things. Which things like this, you probably should appreciate. It's a work of beauty. He's an individual typing behind a computer desk has trolled the largest cable news network by assets, or the first cable news network, at least, CNN. I don't know if they're, I think by assets, they're still bigger than Fox. He trolled them, and they're suffering from it now. And we're gonna be seeing more and more of this. There's gonna be just this hemorrhaging of people at CNN that they're gonna lose their they've already lost their credibility, so that the only people who believe CNN are the ones who really can't think for themselves anymore and that don't know any better. So until next time, I don't know when I'm going to call this video yet. I was going to call it Give P a Chance, and I'm trying to come up with like something a little more classy, because I'm trying to keep this channel classy and informative and sophisticated, but CNN won't let me. They're just serving up these softballs, and I'm just, anybody can hit them out of the park. You don't even need to be a smart person to see that a story like that just erodes your credibility. So once again, this is Bold Like a Leopard, Ramon, B-O-L-D in capital letters, on Facebook, strutting leopard.blogspot.com. Look for my education piece to come out this weekend sometime, maybe even before that, on that blog, and we'll see you around the bend.